Yesterday we started with the new module, which is module number 3, and it is called as what? Microwave tubes. So basically we studied why microwave tubes were required, because the conventional microwave tubes like the triodes, tetrodes, pentodes, etc. were failing at very high frequencies, especially above 300 megahertz, right? And what were the causes of the failure? They were inter-electrode capacitance, lead inductance effect, transit time effect due to RF losses and radiation losses, right? However, the main cause was transit time effect. And what is transit time effect? We have already seen in electromagnetics course, right? However, I have mentioned here irony. What is the irony? That researchers use this transit time to their advantage to design the microwave tubes which were working for more than 300 megahertz. And they designed microwave tubes like klystrons, TWTs and magnetrons. So today we'll go one step further and study one more microwave tube referring to klystron, and we'll also study a TWT, which stands for traveling wave tube. So then we studied how microwave tubes work. Basically what they do, we have an electron beam, so you can consider this as an analogous thing to BJT. So DC source gives the extra power to the analog signal or the AC signal, right? So in the same way, electron beam gives the power to the RF signal for amplification or for the sustained oscillations. And the microwave tubes are classified into O type, which are also called as linear beam tubes, and M type or crossed beam tubes. So what are O type beam tubes? The electric field lines are aligned with those of electron beam lines, right? So they are called as O type tubes. And this was the classification of the O type tubes. So basically we have klystrons and TWTs which are under this classification. So then we studied M-type tubes. So the electric field lines are perpendicular to the direction of electron beam lines, right? So that is called as M-type tubes, right? So what are the main things which we study here are magnetron, cross field amplifier and PWO, which is also called as carcinotron. So these three devices we study under cross field tubes. So that is the magnetic field and the electric field will be perpendicular to the direction of electron beam. So then we studied the difference between O-type and M-type, like based on devices and energy conversion. And the fields, obviously we saw that they are parallel here and they are perpendicular here. And the gain is provided high by O-type and moderate by M-type. And there were other differences also. We also saw what is octave bandwidth. So this, if this upper bandage is twice the lower bandage, we call this as a octave bandwidth, right? So then this is a very important slide. So you see the electric field, as you know, it always goes away from positive and towards the negative. And since this is a cavity, so it resonates at a particular frequency only, for example 2 gigahertz, right? So if it is starts resonating, it will oscillate and it will generate a frequency corresponding to 2 gigahertz. And since this is a frequency, so it will oscillate. So let's say at an instant of time, the electric field is in this position. So next what will happen? It will be in other position. So again, it will come back to this position and it will keep on oscillating. So that is how a cavity operates. So if the at a particular instant of time, if the electric field is in this position and the electron beam is coming in this direction. So this is the negative polarity for electric field, and electrons by nature are negatively charged. So what will happen? There will be a repulsive force between these two entities, right? Because of this, what will happen? There will be deceleration of electrons. So in the same way, this is the same case, except that the electric field is opposite in direction now. So these are negatively charged again, and this is a positive polarity of electric field now. So what will happen? They will get accelerated. So in this case, there will be acceleration of electrons. So this phenomena together is called as what? Velocity modulation. So this is a very important question, as I told you yesterday. Then we studied two cavity klystron and multi cavity klystron. So what is two cavity klystron? It is called as two cavity because there are two cavities present over here, right? And we have an electron gun which emits a continuous beam of electrons, and we have the focusing electrodes which are used to focus the electrons along this line only. And the distance between the buncher and catcher cavity is called as drift space, while the distance between the focusing electrodes is called as interaction space. And the collector is positively charged because it is connected to the positive potential, and the electron gun, since it has to emit electrons, is obviously connected to a negative potential. And how is the velocity of electrons decided? It is decided by the beam potential here, right? And these are the cavities which resonate at a particular frequency. So if these cavities resonate at 2 gigahertz, so we can apply input corresponding to 2 gigahertz only, else the circuit will not work, right? So let's say I am giving an input of 2 gigahertz here because the cavity resonates at 2 gigahertz. So what will happen? When the source is switched on, electrons will start traveling from left to the right. But what will happen, as discussed in this slide, there will be this electric field which will be keep on oscillating between these two things, these two slides, right? Because of this, there will be what, continuous acceleration and deceleration of electrons. So where will it start? The acceleration or deceleration of electrons, it will not start here, remember. I didn't mention this point yesterday. It will start at the moment with the electrons reach gap A. So from this cavity, the acceleration and deceleration of electrons will start. So after passing through some distance, electron bunches will start forming, right? And this drift space distance is decided such that the bunch exactly come at this cavity, okay? So that can be set, okay? So if the bunch arrives exactly here, what will happen? This input signal is corresponding to 2 gigahertz. So the electric field was also oscillating corresponding to 2 gigahertz. So the bunches which are formed, they are also formed corresponding to a resonant frequency of 2 gigahertz, right? So when they arrive here, what is this cavity? It is tuned to 2 gigahertz. So since the electrons bunch are formed at 2 gigahertz, so they will induce an electric field here, right? So what was happening? The bunches were formed due to electric field here, right? Now the other way it will form here, because of the bunch, the electric field will get induced here. Why it will get induced? Because this cavity is again resonate at 2 gigahertz, and the bunches are also corresponding to 2 gigahertz, so they will induce the electric field here. So because of this electric field, a magnetic field will be generated and will get an electromagnetic wave which can be taken out through this output, right? So we'll get an amplified signal here. Why we'll get an amplified signal? Because these bunches are forming, right? So these bunches will give their energy to the RF signal in the form of electric field here, right? So the electron beam power is converted to RF power. So this is a two cavity klystron. But what is the problem of this klystron? The gain is very low. So what we do? We use multi cavity klystron. So what we do? We insert one or two more cavities here. So the first bunch which is formed for the first bunch which is formed will come here, so it will induce a signal here, right? So this process will multiply, and as there are more and more cavities, more bunches will be formed with more strength, and more amplification will be achieved. So high gain will be achieved in this way. So, and this is what, this is called as apple gate diagram, corresponding to velocity modulation. So corresponding to zero potential will have no change in velocity, right? But when there is a positive potential, what we saw in the previous slide is there is an accelerating field generated. So the velocity is increased. So that's why the slope is increased. This is distance, this is time. So the slope gives the velocity. So since slope increases, means velocity increases. But here we encounter a negative potential, so velocity will decrease. So you see that they meet at a point. So they are forming a bunch, right? So this is called as velocity modulation. So this comes for 10 marks, right? So then we said that if the cavities are tuned to slightly different frequencies, this is called a staggered tuning. So bandwidth, advantage of this is bandwidth will be increased, but the gain of the amplifier will be reduced, because obviously the cavities are tuned to a particular frequency only. So if they are tuned to different frequencies, the some signal will be lost. So then we saw this summary also. So then the next topic is reflex klystron. So what was the previous klystrons we study? Remember, they were acting as amplifiers, right? So if you get a question, explain klystron as an amplifier, you should write this answer. But if you get a question like explain klystron as a oscillator, you should write the answer as reflex klystron. So reflex klystron is a low power, low efficiency microwave oscillator. What do you mean by low efficiency? Means the beam to mode conversion efficiency, means the electron beam power which is getting converted to RF power, that efficiency is very low. So less amount of electron beam power is transferred to the RF wave. That is understood from low efficiency. And it is a single cavity variable frequency microwave generator. Single cavity means what? Here there were three cavities. So instead of that, we have only one cavity in a reflex klystron. What do you mean by variable frequency? Since it is a cavity, it can be, if you change the dimensions of the cavity, the tuning frequency will change. So that's why it is a variable frequency microwave generator. So oscillator can also be called as what? Generators, because it acts as a source, right? And it is widely used in applications where variable frequency is desired, like radar receiver and microwave receivers. So this is the geometry of a reflex klystron. So if you see, there is a single cavity here. Okay. So what is there again? We have a DC voltage source. So this is connected to the negative potential, remember, and a positive potential is connected to the cavity. Why is this so? Because the electron should get attracted towards the cavity. But there is one more potential with a negative potential connected here. It is called as repairer plate. So why that is the case, we'll see in some time. So how will the electrons travel? They will travel upwards because this is positively charged. Apart from that, we also have accelerating grids, because this is just positively charged. We want them to travel with some velocity. So we'll use a accelerating grid, or you can also see a focusing electrode also. So the electrons will obviously travel in the upward direction, right? So they will travel upwards, but what will happen as they move upwards? They will encounter this repeller space, so the electrons will get repelled. So they can't go further here. So they will get repelled, and somehow they will form a bunch. So somehow, how they form a bunch, we'll see in the next slide. So they will form a bunch and they will come across this cavity. Okay. So what happens here, that we'll see in the next slide. So this is the diagram for mechanism of oscillation. This is what a oscillator, right? So how oscillations are sustained in the reflex klystron, that we'll see here. So we have a cavity here, right? This is a circular cavity, cylindrical cavity shown here. Here it is shown as a rectangular cavity. That doesn't make a difference, you don't worry about that. Since this is a cavity, again this will correspond to a resonant frequency, right? So let's say again the resonant frequency is 2 GHz. So now you might say, sir, there is no AC source. Obviously there is no source, right? Because this is oscillator. From basic theory EDC, you should know that oscillator does not have any input. So how is the oscillator generating the frequency, particular frequency? So you have studied in EDC that it generates through the noise which is present in the DC source. So what will happen, this DC source, when switched on, it does not give a stable frequency directly, sorry, stable voltage directly. For example, let's say it is 100 volts. So if 100 volts is generated from this, it will directly not give 100 volts. Initially it will give a pulse signal which will vary from 0 to 100 volts or maybe 110 volts. So corresponding to that fluctuation, a noise, or that which is actually called as noise, that noise will resonate with the particular frequency of this cavity. Since it is a noise, it will have almost all the frequencies. And one of the frequency will obviously be resonating with this frequency. So let's say it is 2 GHz. So 2 GHz will resonate with this frequency. And since this resonator supports 2 GHz frequency, it will allow that frequency to propagate. Okay. So that is the reason, that is how we are getting this oscillations. So at the start, these oscillations will obviously be very low. But somehow we want them to be sustained. Right. So that's why we are using this electron power. So we want this electron power to somehow get transferred to the AC power, or this frequency, right? So this is the AC signal which is generated from the noise. So, and since this is the cathode or the electron gun, the electrons are moving upwards. So we have 2 points here, A, B and C. So again, this is the case like the apple gate diagram which you saw for 2 cavity klystron. So let's take this point B. This is zero potential, so there is no change in velocity. So it goes some path above, then encounters the repeller which is at a negative voltage, so gets repelled and comes to this positive peak of the AC voltage. So this distance T naught is kept such that the repeller, the waves or the electrons coming, hit at the positive peak only. Then let's take the point T. So what is happening at point A? We have a positive potential, right? So we have seen in the starting slides that if the electrons encounter a positive potential, they are accelerated, right? So what will happen here? The point A, they will get accelerated. So since they are accelerated, they are traveling with high velocity, so they will travel farther than the electron which was at B. So we show more to, they go more towards the repeller, right? But finally, anyways, they have to get repelled because this is the repeller R. So they get repelled, and the distance is kept such that they hit at the positive peak, this distance corresponding to T naught. Okay, So then at corresponding to C, this is negative potential, so obviously the electrons will be decelerated, right? So they travel with less velocity. So what is happening? This is traveling with no change in velocity. This is traveling with more velocity. This is traveling with less velocity. So obviously again they will form a bunch at some time, right? So this distance again is kept such that that bunch is obtained at a positive peak. Okay, so why we want at positive peak? Because we want the oscillations to be sustained, right? So if the electrons form a bunch and hit this peak, what will happen? They'll transfer the energy, the electron beam energy, to the AC signal, right? So on this AC signal can sustain because of that. Okay, so this is how oscillations are sustained. How, why they will be sustained? Because this electron gun is continuously bombarding electrons, right? Once we have the starting, even though very low amplitude AC signal from the noise, since this is hitting here, it will sustain the oscillations, and this process will keep on continuing, and finally, and we get that output from here using a coaxial cable. Okay, so this is the operation of a reflex crystal. So then again, this is the sinusoidal signal, the points A, B and C. So corresponding to A, we have a increased velocity, corresponding to C, we have less velocity, and corresponding to B, we have no change in velocity, right? So what is happening? So corresponding to point B, till this distance, how many quarter cycles are there? 3/4, right? And what is the period of the signal from this point A to this peak? It is period of the signal is T, right? So from B, how, what is the distance traveled by the no change in velocity electron? 3/4. Right. So what this diagram tells us is you can set this distance to be corresponding to this point B. So if you keep this like this much distance, you will get 3/4. If you keep one period extra from here, it will be 1 3/4 or 2 3/4 and so on. So this is the T naught, right, which you saw here. So this is from point B to this point, right? So depending on this point, we will get where the this electron bunch is hitting the AC signal, right? So this corresponds to modes of oscillation. So that is given by n plus 3/4 times T. So if n is 0, what we get? 3/4 T means we have selected this where the electrons are hitting, electron bunch is hitting to be precise. So if you have set this as 2 cycles, or then how, what is the mode? It is 1 3/4, because if you substitute the value 1 here, what you will get? 1 3/4 T, right? So in this way, these modes are defined. Okay, so this is about what? Reflex klystron. Okay, so we are done with klystrons. So next, we study something called as slow wave structures. So the first question is again, why we study slow wave structures? So the RF wave, at what speed it travels? We have proved again in electromagnetics that the electromagnetic wave, which is nothing but the RF wave or the radio frequency wave, it travels at the speed of light. From Maxwell's equations, we have proved it. However, what we want? We want interaction between the RF wave and the electrons. But the problem is the electrons travel at a speed which is considerably less than that of light. Hence, there is no beam wave interaction. So slow wave structures are used to overcome this problem. Okay. So what are slow wave structures? They are basically used to reduce the velocity of the RF wave so as to become equal to that of the electrons, so that the efficient beam wave interaction is achieved and amplification or oscillations are achieved. Okay. So there are various slow wave structures. So this is a helical line slow wave structure. So this is a slow wave structure in the form of helix. Okay, so how this works as a slow wave structure, we'll see in the next slide. So this is also a slow wave structure. So all these are examples of slow wave structures. So this comes in the exam for 5 marks. Okay, so this is a diagram of a helix traveling wave tube, or abbreviated as TWT. Why is it called as helix traveling wave tube? Is because the RF input is going through this slow wave structure like this. So how does this act like a slow wave structure? Is if you have this straight line and if you give an input here, it will travel at the speed of light, right? But if you give the RF signal a helical form, it has to travel a greater distance as compared to the straight line, right? So even though it travels at the speed of light, what is happening? The axial component, if you resolve this, the axial component will be traveling at a speed which is less than that of light, right? So this is how the slow wave structure is achieving the reduced velocity as compared to that of lead. So we keep this number of turns and the distance between the helices, these two helices, or the which is called as the pitch, such that the velocity of the RF wave is approximately equal to this beam velocity, so that efficient interaction takes place. So again, this is my electron gun, so which bombards the electrons. This is the collector, so this is positively charged, this is negatively charged, and this is biased by a magnetic field. So magnet is placed here, so this rectangular stuff which you are seeing are nothing but the magnets. So they help to keep the electron beam as a pencil beam, it is called as, so that they don't go haywire, that is they don't go in the transverse direction, so we want them only in the axial direction. Okay, so again the RF input is traveling like this, so it has to travel a larger distance, right? So its axial component is traveling at a speed which is less than that of lead, and the electron beam is also traveling axially, so there can be a good interaction between the electrons and the RF input, right? But a very important thing to achieve the interaction is that is mentioned here purposely, as the DC velocity of the beam is maintained slightly greater than the phase velocity of the traveling wave. Means the electron beam velocity should be slightly greater than the velocity of the traveling wave. Why this is so? Because if this velocity is more, what will happen when the electric field is in this position? If the electric field is in this position, this velocity is high, so more electrons will get retarded, right? So there will be more retardation than acceleration. That is what is meant by velocity of beam is maintained slightly greater than traveling wave. So you should understand that when the electrons, so this will again form bunches, because the electric field is again what traveling sinusoidally, right? This is sinusoidal input. So electron, the arrow will first point towards right, then the arrow will point towards left, and so on. So there will be continuous acceleration and deceleration of electrons. So again, electron bunches are forming here. But the DC velocity of beam, that is electron velocity of the beam, is maintained slightly greater than velocity of traveling wave. So what will this do? There will be more deceleration of electrons because of this. So more electrons face the retarding field than the accelerating field. So what will happen? Great amount of kinetic energy is transferred from the beam to the electromagnetic field. So you can think, you can take a simple analogy. If you are running very fast and you just try to stop abruptly, what will happen? Your moment of inertia will take you a bit forward, right? So in the same way, if the electrons are traveling and you have kept the electron beam velocity slightly greater than the rate of traveling wave, so more electrons are facing retarding field, so they are made to stop abruptly. So what will happen? They'll have, because of moment of inertia, sort of, they'll again give the energy to the RF wave. So this is how the oscillations will be achieved. So what will happen? So as they travel further, what will happen? More bunches will be formed. So, and as the electrons are traveling further in the form of bunches, so more amplification will be occurring in this way. So this is exponential growth of RF signal. How do we achieve this? Because the bunches are going to continuously form along this path, and there will be more retarding field and more electrons facing the retarding field. Because, so let's say I am here, so if I face the retarding field here, the energy will be transferred to the helix or the RF wave, so amplification occurs, but these electrons are continuously coming, right? So more bunches are formed here, and the RF wave has already amplified a bit, so again the electrons will again face retardation here, so again they will give the energy to RF wave. Same thing will happen here. So that is how this exponential growth is achieved in the helix TWT. Okay. So then we have the comparison between klystron and TWT. So both are O-type devices, obviously. But what is the main difference? That klystron, we used cavities. So we didn't use any cavities here. So this is non-resonant, right? So because of this, it is a wide band device, TWT, and this is a narrow band device. Okay. But we saw that it requires an external magnetic field, right? It does not require external magnetic field. So that is another difference. And because it requires external magnetic field, TWT is complex and as well as bulky. And this is not bulky because it does not require external magnetic field. So if you have a doubt that how does a external magnetic field increase the weight of the system, so if you have to give a magnetic field, obviously you will require magnets, and magnets are, and you will require a magnetic field in the range of at least 0.5 to 1 tesla or 2 tesla. So that requires, and even though the number sounds very small, 0.5 tesla, 1 tesla, this is amounting to thousands of gauss. So that is a very huge magnetic field actually. So it requires a huge amount of magnets, which will again take, which will make the system bulky. So because of these magnets, the TWT can become bulky. So this is the difference. So then what are the advantages? As we saw, since it is a non-resonant structure, it is a wide band device. So bandwidth is more than the klystron amplifier. And since again there is no resonant cavity, there is no tuning problem. Because what is the problem in cavity is the dimensions of the cavity should be very exact. If the dimensions of the cavity are not exact, if you are trying to design for 2 gigahertz, and if there is a difference of, let's say, 15 to 20 mm or 1 to 2 mm, it might affect the tuning of the 2 gigahertz exactly. So it might resonate at 1.9 gigahertz instead of 2 gigahertz. So that will be a bit of a problem. So that is not a problem faced in TWT. So then applications, one of the most important applications apart from those mentioned here is it is used in satellite communication. So even though it is bulky, the reason it is used is because it can give high power output. So that is used in satellite communication. So all the satellites which are launched into space, most of them contain this TWT amplifier. And you have already studied satellite communication, I suppose. So you might have that block diagram of a satellite communication system. So in that you might have seen a TWT amplifier. So that is nothing but this TWT amplifier. Okay. So these are two devices. So I am not taking more than two devices for this module, so that you have time to reflect on those. And obviously make your notes and reflect on them. And if you have any doubts, you can always post in classroom. Okay. So we'll stop for today here and we'll continue tomorrow.